Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description box and also in the comment section. Now let's move on to the analysis of first news article.
This editorial article is with reference to the situation in Jammu and Kashmir. The author has given an opinion on what should be the next move of Indian government with respect to the union territory of Jammu and Kashmir. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this editorial is highlighted here for your reference. In the last 2-3 days, Jammu and Kashmir is in news mainly because the former chief minister of J&K, Mr. Farooq Abdullah, has been released from the almost 7-month long detention. He was kept in detention under the Jammu and Kashmir Public Safety Act after the central government abrogated the temporary provisions that were present in Article 370 of Indian Constitution. Now, with respect to the release of the former chief minister, the author has welcomed the move of the government as it may lead to fresh political possibilities in the region, and the release of a popular leader will help to reopen the public space in Kashmir Valley, which is in a lockdown since August 2019. There were petitions in the Supreme Court against the lockdown, and the Supreme Court has asked the Union government to take steps proportionate to the situation warranted. And even recently, the lockdown in J&K was relaxed as the mobile telephony was restored fully. However, the mobile internet was restored partially. And there was also assurances from the side of government, Prime Minister, that there might be restoration of statehood for J&K in the future. Even this was the stand taken by the Home Minister in August 2019 when the reorganization of J&K Act was passed. So these are some of the improvements that can be seen in the region, but know that there are still restrictions on assembly and many are still under detention. Even two former chief ministers of J&K, son of Mr. Farooq Abdullah and Ms. Mehmooba Mufti. So most probably the release of these two chief ministers will be the next step towards attaining normalcy in the region. So based on the recent developments in the region, the author has given some suggestions. So what should be the next move of Indian government? First and foremost requirement is openness from the side of Government of India. This is because for various actions taken by Government of India, there have been no reasons mentioned by the Government of India. Even for example, the Supreme Court in the recent verdict with respect to lockdown has stated that the orders with respect to restraining telecom facilities have to be made public. The Supreme Court observed that the orders with reference to temporary suspension of telecom services, say under temporary suspension of telecom services, public emergency or public safety rules of 2017, have to be declared public, as earlier, particularly in J&K, it was not available in the public domain. And even the recent release of former chief minister was seen skeptical by some sections in J&K, as they think there could be a different political intention behind it. So in this scenario, there is a need to bridge the trust deficit that is between the people of J&K and the Government of India. So to restore the trust, openness is required. Then the author suggests that the centre must try and undo the damage that was done to some of the mainstream political parties in J&K. These are parties such as National Conference and Jammu and Kashmir People Democratic Party. The main reason why the term damage has been used is with reference to detention of political leaders from these both parties under the J&K Public Safety Act. Most probably with the release of other political leaders and the two other chief ministers, this problem can be undone from the side of Government of India. Then the author presumes that center has a baseless notion that communities in J&K will surrender their political autonomy in return for material prosperity. Here the political autonomy may refer to the scenario that was guaranteed by erstwhile provisions in Article 370, Article 35A, and then separate constitution for J&K, which was the scenario before August 2019. However, at present, with the amendment to Article 370, now there is no special status or temporary provisions for the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. So in this regard, what could be a proper way to understand the demand of political autonomy could be aptly given by restoring the statehood to J&K. And the author also suggests that center must allow all opinions with respect to the region and no force or no coercive measures should be adopted except for combating violence. So the Union government's approach towards J&K has to be people-centric, which should be guided by a resolute commitment for diversity and religious pluralism of J&K, taking into consideration of all communities in the Union territory. And the Government of India, as we know, has to play a very important role in not allowing either the Taliban or the Pakistan in exploiting the present situation of J&K. And we have been seeing that Taliban has been in the strongest point while negotiating the US-Taliban deal, whereas US was in the weaker point, and the signing of the deal was considered as a victory for religious fundamentalist force in South Asia and also rippling foreign forces in Afghanistan soil. And recently we have discussed an editorial where we saw that there could be psychological impact, though not physical impact, among the Indian youth living in Jammu and Kashmir, who may think that a force like Taliban has defeated USA and why not us. So the government of India has to take necessary steps to prevent such psychological impacts on Indian youth, so that the present situation does not turn in favor of Pakistan. These are some of the important information with reference to the analysis of this editorial article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article is with reference to Spain and France, who are both members in European Union and also in NATO alliance. And we know that European Union is one of the most integrated regions in the world. Most significant part in Europe is Schengen area. See, the Schengen area is a zone of 26 European countries. And these countries have abolished the internal borders between the countries so as to have free and unrestricted movement of people. So even from India, if you have Schengen visa, you can visit all these Schengen-denominated countries. However, with the trending coronavirus disease 2019, the free and unrestricted movement of people in these countries is reportedly known to spread the disease as well. So in this context, countries are taking protective measures and also bringing tighter border controls. And in the world outside China, Europe is the most affected region. European Union countries like Italy, France, Spain and Germany. In these countries, we could see more than 100 individuals have died because of COVID-19. So it is in this context, countries are planning for tighter border control with severe restrictions on movement of people to control the spread of the disease. So in this context, let's have a basic information with reference to Schengen area. See, this area covers most of the countries in European Union. However, five countries of European Union are not part of this Schengen area. They are Ireland, Romania, Bulgaria, Croatia and Cyprus. And with reference to European Union, while the recently left country is United Kingdom, the recently joined country is Croatia. Croatia joined European Union in the year 2013. However, it is reported that four countries other than Ireland, they are likely to join Schengen area in the near future. And also know that some countries that are not members of European Union are also members of Schengen area. These are countries like Norway, Iceland, Switzerland and Liechtenstein. We have given this image for your better understanding, where you can see the European Union countries that are part of Schengen, countries that are not part of European Union but part of Schengen, and countries that are part of European Union but not part of Schengen area. Now let us take up a practice question based on Spain. They're asking, Spain shares border with which of the following? Mediterranean Sea, Gibraltar, Atlantic Ocean, North Sea, France. See, Spain is the second largest country in European Union after France. Capital of Spain is Madrid. It shares land border with Portugal, then with France, then with the European Union, a recognized member state, Andorra. Then it also shares border with a territory called as Gibraltar, which is presently a territory of United Kingdom. Other than these land borders, we can also see that Spain is bounded by water. In the east and southeast, it shares maritime border with Mediterranean Sea. In the northwest and in the southwest, it shares maritime boundary with Atlantic Ocean. Even it shares border with Bay of Biscay. Also know that Canary Islands, which is located in Atlantic, in the west of North African region, is also a part or territory of Spain. For this question, if you know the location of North Sea, which we can observe north to Germany or north to Belgium or Netherlands, no way it is connected with Spain. So you can easily eliminate options B and options D. And if you know that Spain is having border with Atlantic Ocean, obviously you can arrive at the correct answer, option C, 1, 2, 3 and 5. So the correct answer for this question is option C. And initially we saw that both Spain and France, they are members of NATO as well. NATO is an alliance at present having 29 independent member countries. And it includes countries such as Portugal, Germany and France as well. Recently on March 1, we discussed about the status or designation of major non-NATO ally by the United States. That day we saw that Afghanistan is one of the major non-NATO ally of US. Know that India is not one of the major non-NATO ally of US. However, our neighbor Pakistan is one of the major non-NATO ally of United States. Whereas India is a major defense partner of United States since 2016. We have given the 17 countries as a list here, which are designated as major non-NATO ally by US for your reference. Now let's move on to next news article. This news article mentions about a report by the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Labour. This committee has made some reservations on various schemes and projects that are implemented by Ministry of Labour and Employment. We'll see some of the observations made by the committee in this discussion. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, the report by Parliamentary Standing Committee on Labour, it has noted that there is underutilization of funds by the Ministry of Labour and Employment. According to news article, the ministry has utilized just above 80% of around 11,000 crore allocated to it for the financial year 2020. And this was the situation as on 10th February 2020. So the ministry is yet to spend the remaining 20% of allocated budget within a span of like 50 days. Now, among the underutilization of funds for government schemes and projects, the committee found that the least utilization of funds is with reference to the National Career Service Project. In contrast, with reference to a scheme called as Pradhan Mantri Rojgar Protsahan Yojana, the ministry has recorded absolute utilization of funds, or in other words, 100% utilization of funds. See, this Pradhan Mantri Rojgar Protsahan Yojana, it gives incentives to employers to generate new employment. Now, in this Ministry of Labour and Employment, the funds utilization percentage is around 70% and above for various schemes other than National Career Service. Now, with reference to National Career Service, the fund utilization was only almost 61%. So in this context, let us see in brief about this National Career Service project, which will be helpful in prelims perspective, and you may highlight the role of this service in mains answer writing in GS3 under Indian economy and issues relating to employment. See, there is an e-governance plan for the central government. It is an umbrella program which has several mission mode projects. And National Career Service is one of the mission mode projects under this umbrella of e-governance plan. It is a 5-year mission mode project. This project was launched by Pradhan Mantri or Prime Minister in the year 2015 in July. So who is implementing this project? See, this project is implemented by Directorate General of Employment, who comes under the Ministry of Labour and Employment. One of the objectives of this career service project is to transform the existing National Employment Service that aims to bring a better matching of demand and supply of work opportunities. See, this National Employment Service, which is also called as National Employment Exchange, is also a program that is operated by Director General of Employment and Training under Ministry of Labour and Employment. This National Career Service is said to be providing one-stop solution as it provides a wide range of employment and career-related services to Indian citizens. It bridges the gap between job seekers and employers, and it bridges the gap between who are seeking for training and career guidance and the agencies that are providing training and career guidance or career counseling. So, as a platform, it facilitates convergence of information and it creates synergies or cooperation among various stakeholders like job seekers, employers, counselors, trainers, even private placement agencies. Now, let's see the focus areas of this National Career Service platform. One is to enhance career and employment opportunities. Then they focus on counseling and guidance for career development. Then they also focus on decent employment. Then they also focus to enhance female labor force participation. And they also encourage entrepreneurial endeavors. Now, with reference to this National Career Service, there are three important pillars. One is that it works through a well-designed information and communication technology-based portal, shortly called as NCS portal. Then they also operate through model career centers. And the third pillar is interlinkage with all the states through employment exchanges. See, this NCS ICT-based portal is a digital centralized portal. It gives various information and services related to career, like job search, job matching, career counseling. It also provides information on job fairs, even services of local service providers like drivers, plumbers. These information about local service providers for households and various other services are also available in this web portal. So this portal facilitates registration of various stakeholders like government departments, households, placement organizations, career centers, as we saw local service providers, skill providers, job seekers, employers, and also career counselors. And coming to model career centers, see what they have done is they have repositioned the employment exchanges that are present already. What they have done is existing 978 employment exchanges were repositioned into model career centers. So as a model career center, they will act as a hub of career related services. These centers, they serve as a platform to address all career related needs of youths and students who are seeking counseling and employment. So end of the day, this National Career Service is an important component to take the information about jobs to all over India, and it also plays a very important role in augmenting the employability of youth in our country. This is because they also try to bridge the gap between those agencies that give training and counseling and those who seek training and counseling. But what we have found is that the allocated budget for this project has not been fully utilized by the ministry. In fact, it is just 60%. So this area has to be given adequate attention by the supervising authorities, and in the days to come, the scenario has to be improved. With this, we come to the end of analysis of this news article. In this article, we saw the issue highlighted by the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Labour. Then we saw about this National Career Service project, which is one of the mission mode projects under e-governance plan of government. We saw a few objectives. We saw how it acts as a one-stop solution. Three essential pillars of this project. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article mentions about the decision taken by Taratarini Development Board in the state of Odisha. The board has decided to cancel an annual festival called as Chaitra Jatra. The decision has been taken to contain or to prevent the spread of coronavirus disease 2019. In this context, we'll discuss in brief about this Taratarini temple and also some information about this Chaitra Jatra festival. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now coming to the location of this temple, see, this temple is located in Odisha. To be specific, it is located in Kumari Hills in Ganjam district of Odisha. Recently, on March 10, we saw about Ganjam in Odisha. However, with reference to contamination, to be specific, mercury contamination. Now, coming to this Taratarini temple, it is located on the banks of River Rushikulya. Now, the special feature about this temple is that it is one of the oldest pilgrimage centers of Shaktism in India. So, this Shaktism as a religious philosophy or tradition is a goddess-oriented Hindu tradition. It is based on the legends of death of goddess Sati, who is worshipped as or believed as the wife of Lord Shiva. Religious scripts say that Lord Shiva roamed around the world with the dead body of goddess Sati. Later, the body of Sati was cut into almost 51 parts by Lord Vishnu. We could not ascertain the reasons behind the belief that Lord Vishnu has cut or dismembered the body of goddess Sati. However, the dismembered parts of goddess Sati fell on different parts in the earth, and these sites in which the parts fell have become sacred sites for Shakti worship. And coming to this Ganjam district in Odisha, in which Taratarini temple is there, it is believed that the sthana or the breasts of goddess Sati fell in this place. That is why this site is also called as Sthana Pitha. There are three other important Adi Shakti Pithas. One of the temples is Vimala temple, which is in Jagannath temple complex in Puri in Odisha. Then Kamakya temple in Assam. Then Dakshina Kalika temple in West Bengal. There are several other similar Shakti Pithas across our country. Now coming to this Taratarini temple, there are twin goddesses called as Tara and Tarini, believed as the body parts of goddess Sati. Together they are referred as Taratarini. Some say that together they are the chest of goddess Sati. And these goddesses in this temple, they are believed as once patrons of seafarers and merchants of ancient Kalinga. However, with the conquest of Kalinga in 262 BC by Mauryan Empire, Buddhism has come to this region. According to some sources, after the conquest of Kalinga, they are saying that this Taratarini temple has become an important Vajrayana Buddhist center and was sponsored by merchants and seafarers. So worshipping in this temple is said to protect ships from storms and also from other dangers involved in sea travel or sea voyages. In the mid-2000s, this ancient shrine was renovated and enlarged into a grand temple in classical Odisha-style architecture. And today, this temple is a popular pilgrimage site and it attracts lack of pilgrims and devotees, particularly during Taratarni Mela. This Taratarni Mela is also called as Chaitra Mela or Chaitra Jatra. The name Chaitra is mentioned because of the name of the month of Hindu calendar in this festival is conducted. It is held in Chaitra month of Hindu calendar, which roughly comes during March and April. So what happens here is there will be mass congregation, and the fest involves mass feast where people cook food under open sky and they offer to the goddess to fulfill their wishes. So to prevent mass congregation and to prevent spread of COVID-19, the Taratarni Development Board has decided to cancel all the cultural programs associated with this annual Taratarni Mela. So these are some of the information pertaining to this Jatra. One special feature associated with this name Tarini is because Indian Navy sailboat INSV Tarini was named after this Taratarni Hill Shrine. And this INSV Tarini is very special to India because it is in this indigenously built vessel Navika Sagar Parikrama expedition was executed. See, this Navika Sagar Parikrama can be translated as circumnavigation of the globe by women officers. So this Navika Sagar Parikrama is in consonance with national policy to empower women to attain their full potential. And this INSV Tarini was inducted in the Indian Navy in February 2017. In the same year, a 6-member all-women crew, they took a challenging and daunting task of circumnavigating the globe from 10th September 2017 and have successfully completed their voyage on 21st May 2018. The vessel was skippered by Lieutenant Commander Vartika Joshi. And here, for our prelims perspective, one important point is that this vessel has met all criteria for circumnavigating the world. What are the criteria? See, one criteria is crossing the equator twice, then crossing all longitudes. Then the third important criteria is crossing 3 great capes of the world. These 3 capes are Cape Leeuwin, Cape Horn, and Cape of Good Hope. Cape Leeuwin is in Australia, Cape Horn is in southern Chile, and Cape of Good Hope, as we know, is an African continent in South Africa. So these are some of the important information pertaining to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This open editorial article is with reference to an ongoing dispute mainly between Egypt and Ethiopia, and also involving Sudan. The dispute is mainly with reference to Great Ethiopian Renaissance Dam that is presently under construction in Ethiopia on the Blue Nile River. In this context, today we'll focus mainly on important tributaries and the dams of Nile River, for which White Nile River and Blue Nile River are tributaries. And based on these matters, we'll take up this question, which is asking us to select the pairs that are correctly matched. See, the Nile Basin River system, it flows through 11 countries in African continent. From the news article, we can easily say Sudan, Egypt, Ethiopia. Other countries are Burundi, Democratic Republic of Congo, Eritrea, Kenya, Rwanda, South Sudan, Tanzania, and Uganda. See, Nile River is the longest river in the world. The length of this river is about 6,670 kilometers. And as we saw already, important tributaries are Blue Nile and White Nile. The Blue Nile and White Nile, they merge in Sudan. And the Nile River passes through Egypt and finally drains into or empties into Mediterranean Sea. So as we can observe, this Nile River basin is very important for riparian states, say Ethiopia, Sudan, South Sudan, Egypt, and even other countries. Now let's see some of the important dams with reference to the river. We can see a dam constructed on White Nile in Sudan, and this dam is called as White Nile Dam. And in Sudan itself, across Blue Nile, there is a dam. That dam is called as Sennar Dam. And very importantly, in Egypt, there is a dam called as Aswan Dam. And right now, we are discussing about a dispute with reference to one dam called as GERD or Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam under construction in Ethiopia. See, the construction of this Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam in Ethiopia has been started in the year 2011, and it is expected to be completed as soon as possible. And once it is completed, it is touted that it will be the Africa's biggest hydroelectric power plant. So as per the government of Ethiopia, they are to start storing water in the dam, and they will generate power from December 2020. However, storing water in this dam is said to generate concerns, more importantly in Egypt and also in Sudan. And in addition to these matters, two other important information you can take from the news article. One is with reference to the Prime Minister of Ethiopia, Mr. Abiy Ahmed. He was known because last year, the Nobel Prize for Peace was awarded to Abiy Ahmed. And the main reason why he was awarded Nobel Peace Prize is for his efforts to achieve peace and international cooperation, and in particular for his decisive initiative to resolve the border conflict with Eritrea. However, it has been recently observed that he has been very assertive with respect to storing water in this dam. And news article also talks about Arab League, which has asked Ethiopia not to take any unilateral step. So what they are asking is that Ethiopia should take into consideration the concerns of Egypt and other neighboring countries with respect to this dam cum hydroelectric power project. See, Arab League, or the League of Arab States, is actually a voluntary association of countries whose people are mainly Arabic speaking, or these are the countries where Arabic is an official language. This league was founded in the year 1945. At present, it is having around 22 members, and know that Ethiopia is not one of the member country. And more importantly, the state of Palestine is a member country in this Arab League. And we also know that state of Palestine is also a member country in Organization of Islamic State. Now let's come to the original discussion, based on which let us solve this prelims practice question. So as we saw, the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, we can easily arrive at the correct answer because the term Ethiopia is in the name of the dam. So here, second pair is incorrectly matched. Both White Nile Dam, see, White Nile Dam is in Sudan and Aswan Dam is in Egypt. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now let's move on to next news article. This picture-based news article states that Border Roads Organization is clearing snow at the Zojila Pass. Based on this article, let us take one question based on passes. They have given passes and where they are situated, and they are asking which among the above pairs are matched incorrectly. They are saying Zojila is situated in Ladakh. See, this pair is correct. Zojila Pass is situated on Great Himalayas. It is situated at an altitude of 11,578 feet above the sea level. To be specific, it is situated on National Highway 1, called as Srinagar-Kargil-Leh National Highway. And this pass serves as only link between Ladakh and Kashmir. It is a high mountain pass, and one has to cross this high mountain pass to reach Ladakh region from Kashmir Valley. So this pass is called as a gateway to Ladakh. And know that this pass remains closed during winters due to heavy snowfall. As a result, the entire Ladakh region of India is cut off from Kashmir through road connectivity. So to provide all-weather connectivity between Kashmir and Ladakh, Government of India has initiated construction of a tunnel in this pass. And in May 2018, Prime Minister has kick-started the work for this Zojila tunnel. See, it is a 14-kilometer long tunnel. There are two lanes and it is a bi-directional single-tube tunnel. And this will become India's longest road tunnel. And after the construction, it will become the longest bi-directional tunnel in Asia. By the construction of this tunnel, there will be all-weather connectivity between Srinagar, Kargil and Leh. This will cut down the present time taken significantly to cross the Zojila Pass. Presently, it takes around 3.5 hours to cross the pass. With the tunnel, it will be reduced to just 15 minutes. In addition to reducing the time, the tunnel is also expected to make driving more safe and convenient. Now let's come to the second pair. Here they have matched Shipkila Pass with Sikkim. See, this pair is wrongly matched. This is because Shipkila Pass is not situated in Sikkim, but situated in Kinaur district of Himachal Pradesh. It is located in eastern part of Indo-Tibetan border at an altitude of 5,571 meters. Also know that River Satluj enters the Kinaur region near Shipkila Pass in the northeast. Now let's come to next pair, which states that Nathula Pass is situated in Himachal Pradesh. This is wrong because Nathula Pass is situated in Sikkim. Know that before 1962, Nathula Pass was a major corridor of passage between India and Tibet. However, in 1962, it was closed. Nathula Pass is located around some 55 kilometers from Gangtok in Sikkim at an altitude of 14,400 feet. And Indian tourists, they are allowed to go close to international border. And they can see even the Chinese soldiers on the other side of the border. This pass is open for Indians 5 days a week. However, they need required permission from Tourism and Civil Aviation Department through a registered travel agency. Know that foreign nationals are not allowed to visit Nathula Pass, and photography is also strictly prohibited in this area. Now coming to this question, here second and third pairs are incorrectly matched. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 2 and 3. This news article states that a bench of National Company Law Appellate Tribunal is being constituted in Chennai so as to handle matters arising from southern states. So as per the notification, there will be a Chennai-based bench and this will hear the appeals against the orders of benches of National Company Law Tribunal that has jurisdiction in southern states and UTs like Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Lakshadweep and Puducherry. The principal bench of NCLAT will be the existing bench at New Delhi only, and NCLAT at New Delhi will continue to hear appeals other than those in the jurisdiction of Chennai NCLAT. This notification of the government is to come into effect from day after tomorrow, that is from 18th March 2020. So this is considered to be a step taken by the government to strengthen NCLT and NCLAT in terms of number of benches, number of members, primarily to reduce the pendency of litigations related to corporate matters. We have discussed in detail about National Company Law Tribunal and National Company Law Appellate Tribunal in our analysis on 19th November 2019. So you may watch this video with reference to understanding about the functions of NCLAT, NCLT, legality, composition and other parameters. Now let's take a question based on NCLAT. National Company Law Appellate Tribunal was constituted under Section 410 of Companies Act 2013. It hears appeals against the orders of National Company Law Tribunals under Companies Act of 2013, against the orders passed by National Company Law Tribunals under Section 61 of IBC 2016, then against the orders passed by Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India under Section 202 and 211 of IBC. Note that all the given statements are correct. Therefore, the correct answer is option D. In addition to these, NCLAT is also the appellate tribunal to hear and dispose appeals against any direction issued or any decision made or orders passed by Competition Commission of India, however, pertaining to the matter of awarding compensation or Section 53 capital N of Competition Act of 2002. And note that any order of NCLAT may be appealed at the Supreme Court, however, within 60 days from the date of receipt of order of NCLAT. This is based on Section 423 of Companies Act of 2013. So the correct answer here is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Now let us see other practice questions that are displayed along with the news articles. See, this question is with reference to Pradhan Mantri Rojgar Protsohan Yojana. They are asking which of the following statements is correct and to select correct answer from the code given below. See, Rojgar in Hindi means employment and Protsohan means encouragement. This program is to incentivize employers who are registered with Employees Provident Fund Organization. They are incentivized for creating jobs. How they are incentivized is, they are incentivized because of the contribution made by Government of India. The Government of India will be paying the full contribution of the employer made for employee pension scheme and also for Employees Provident Fund. If you see the first statement, it states under the scheme, Government of India will be paying full employer's contribution towards employee pension scheme only. This statement is wrong because of the word only. Even the second statement, where it says Government of India will be paying the full employer's contribution towards employees' provident fund only. But we know that after April 2018, government has been paying the full contribution of employer towards both employee pension scheme and also employees' provident fund. So both these statements are incorrect. Therefore, the correct answer is option D, neither 1 nor 2, because both are incorrect. Now note that the benefits or the contribution of government for employers' contribution towards the scheme and the fund is for new employment and will be eligible for first 3 years of the employment of an individual only. And they are saying the entire system is online and other-based and there is no human interface in the implementation of the scheme. Now, one of the direct benefit of the scheme is that eligible workers, they will have access to social security benefits of organized sector. There are two benefits of implementing the scheme. One is that the employer is incentivized for increasing employment base of workers in the establishment. And secondly, a huge number of workers will find jobs in those establishments that are registered with Employees Provident Fund Organization. Now note that all establishments that are registered with EPFO under EPF Act of 1952, they can apply for availing benefits under the scheme from Government of India. There is one another important criteria. These benefits are targeted for employees earning wages less than or equal to rupees 15,000 per month. Therefore, new employees earning wages more than 15,000 per month, they are not eligible under the scheme. So correct answer is option D, neither 1 nor 2. Now this question is with reference to Taratarini Mela in India's culture and tradition. See, this Taratarni Mela is a festival that is annually conducted or celebrated in Taratarni Temple in Kumari Hills in Ganjam district in Odisha. And this temple, Taratarni Temple, is one of the oldest pilgrimage centers for Shaktism in India. We know that Shaktism is a tradition associated with goddess Sati. And therefore, the correct answer for this question is option C. It is a festival associated with Shaktism tradition in Odisha.
With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar AS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll meet you tomorrow.